So it's been 1 year since my trip to Southeast Asia, and the whole thing was a great experience. But when I think back on it, there's one week in particular that stands out above all the rest. And it's when I did the Hajiang Loop. So Hajiang is a large province in northern Vietnam, and it's somewhat unknown to most tourists. It's vast, it's beautiful, but it's also extremely dangerous. The ever-changing weather conditions make it a risky drive for any foreigner who isn't used to the environment, and the tight, twisting roads through the mountains create dangerous terrain for even the most experienced locals. Now, I didn't know any of that. I'd spent some time in Hanoi, the capital city of Vietnam, and I'd heard from a friend about this place in the north where you could rent a scooter and drive around in the mountains for a couple days. And I thought, I like scooters. I like mountains. So I took a shuttle and an overnight bus out of the big city and into a small town known as Pyeongtaeng. I woke up early on day one to find a little friend sleeping with me.
Very good.
I was able to rent a cheap moped from the hostel I was staying in, and let's just say I was equipped with the best of the best.
Honda Blade mới, sức mạnh song hành.
It's called a Honda Blade, it's not that good. With my bike rented and a tank full of gas, I headed off and got lost about 2 hours in. With my bearings corrected, I headed off again in the right direction. And yeah, it was stuck. Threw on this. What is this called? Parka? No, not a parka. Rain thing. I had never ridden a scooter or moped or anything like that at high speeds before, and I started realizing pretty early on that I was having trouble getting around those tight, narrow corners. Now, I apologize in advance. Some of these shots from the scooter are pretty shaky, but I mean, give me a break. I'm trying to record video with one hand and not drive off a cliff with the other. After doing some research into camber thrust, roll angle, and centripetal force, I learned that you actually have to turn the front wheel in the direction you don't want to go in order to make it around those tight corners. Once I got the hang of it, though, it was pretty easy to get used to, and it changed the metaphorical game when it came to taking those sharp turns. On day two, I began to feel a little bit sick. I think a lot of dust and dirt was blowing in my face, and my fragile little immune system couldn't handle it. So I drank some tea for the first time in my life and invested in this moderately stylish face mask to cover my precious face holes.
We'll see how that works.
I remember the weather was something that changed every like 4.5 minutes. I would be driving up a road in my shorts and t-shirt and then turn a corner and have to layer up with every single piece of clothing in my bag.
Matt told me it would be so hot that I would never wear socks. I really wish I had some socks on.
After riding for a couple hours, I noticed a big cell tower and hiked up this little secret staircase to get there. I ended up finding this old abandoned house or building of some sort and did some hardcore parkour to make my way in. I explored for a good amount of time and it actually had a really nice view from the top. But I had to make a quick getaway after I heard a woman and a little girl walking up from the other side of the mountain. I don't know if they lived there or if they were just coming to do some hardcore parkour too, but I wasn't about to find out. Day three started out relatively calm. I played with some dogs at the hostel and did some more exploring off-road. I had noticed this small trail leading inwards between these huge hills, and after a good 15 minutes of trekking, I discovered a hidden farming field. And I just remember thinking how untouched it seemed.
It's the first time like I haven't really been able to hear any horns or from cars or anything.
Just a bunch of local farmers working peacefully, and this one stupid tourist dressed like an idiot. It was beautiful. Then things took a turn. There's a point in the loop in which you have to make a choice whether you want to go all the way down to the south side or to cut through the middle. My friend had warned me not to go down south. He said the road was made up mostly just of earth and rock, no actual pavement.
I just don't know if I should do the bottom half of this loop.
It was already late in the day when I had to make the decision, but I mean, come on, I took the south road. I learned how bad the roads were pretty quick.
There's a big corner of gravel back there, and I fell. I stepped the thing there.
I didn't even know if there was a hostel or a place to stay where I was going. I had to keep driving. And the further I got, the slower I had to go.
This road is unbelievably bad. I can't go more than 20 kilometers, 15 kilometers per hour in most parts.
And then, seemingly out of nowhere, it became pitch black.
I'm still 22 kilometers from my destination. Still got a ways to go.
I finally made it to a real road with about 15 kilometers left to go, but I realized I had another problem.
I'm so low on gas right now. I'm gonna run out of gas for sure before I get there.
I was climbing this steep mountain for some time, and I could hear that the bike was having trouble. But if I didn't make it up this mountain, I was gonna have to sleep on the side of the road in the pitch black in the middle of nowhere. Literally, the minute I reached the top of the mountain, I completely ran out of gas and the Honda Blade died.
Why can't we be friends? Why can't we be friends? So, I am in neutral. I've been going down a mountain.
After about 45 minutes of that, I rolled right into a town and up to a gas pump.
I just rode 11 kilometers in neutral down a hill. And I made it.
Day four, I was just happy to be alive. I had a delicious breakfast, packed up my gear, and after a few more hours of riding, I made it out of the mountains and back into the town that I started in. And I felt relieved, but also kind of sad that the trip was finished. I mean, those 4 days were some of the most peaceful, scary, intense, but relaxing days of my whole trip. And I wish this video could do Hajang justice, but it can't. I look back at this footage and these photos that I've taken, and it humbles me to have been able to experience this totally different way of life. And I think it puts things into perspective sometimes.